we start talking this morning about Mark's gospel passage that I just read, I think we need to back up a little bit, actually quite a bit. Many years before Jesus is having this conversation with the Pharisees and the scribes, the Jewish people, of which Jesus was one, believed that God had chosen them, that they were a particular people that God had picked out of all the peoples of the earth to be his specific children. And that as long as they followed the laws given by God, and as long as they took care of the temple, then God would protect them, would keep them together as a family, as his children, and would watch over them in a special way. Now, the temple was in Jerusalem, and it was sort of, they believed, is where God was based, was out of Jerusalem, this temple. God could be in other places, but that was sort of the main thing. So it was a big thing for the Jews to take care of the temple and to follow the laws. But about 600 years before Jesus, something happened, and it changed the way they thought. And what happened was this huge empire, the Babylonians, who were the Jews' neighbors, they invaded, and they destroyed this temple that up to this point the Jews felt like was untouchable, that God was protecting. But they tore that temple apart, and then they took these children of God, these chosen people, and they exiled them. They took them all over the place to use as servants for the Babylonian Empire. And so it was many years later that the Jews were able to return home to Jerusalem. And when they did that, they had questions in their mind. We can all imagine that they would. They thought it was time to stop and take stock. What had gone wrong? Why had God, who they believe was going to protect them because they were chosen, why did God allow this thing to happen at their temple, his base, his home, if you will, be destroyed, and then his people scattered all over the land, pulled apart, and so they were asking, what happened? How did we fail God that God allowed this to happen? And it's interesting, we have the Old Testament, and in the Old Testament, there are books that are written with this question in mind. How did we fail God, and how can we make this right? What's even more interesting, though, is that not all the writers of the Old Testament came to the same conclusion. There was a debate among them. Isaiah the prophet, though, he believed the problem that existed was that God cared about all people. And if the Jews had become isolated and seemed to only care about themselves, they were very focused on their own self-preservation and what they were doing. And not only that, but even within the Jewish community, that those who were well-off, those who were prospering, did not really give any focus or attention on the lowest and the poorest, the most vulnerable in their society, even among their own people. And so Isaiah said, here's where we've gone wrong. If we're wondering what God really cares about, what God really wants from us, it's that we are to love and to serve and to care for those hurting in the world, our own hurting, the people in our own community, but those outside of our community too. We're to care about them. That's where we got off track. That's why we lost everything. But not everybody agreed with the prophet Isaiah. In fact, in our Old Testament, there's the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. And they felt like the issue where the Jews had gotten off track was that they had ceased to be holy and pure and righteous. That their lives, they weren't lived as close to the law as they needed to be. And so they wanted to go back to doing the same things they were doing back when they had the temple, but they wanted to do it better. They wanted to obey every single law. In fact, they even created more laws and live a very strict pattern of life and to avoid things that are sinful and evil and dirty. And so that also meant sometimes avoiding those who were hurting and those who were needing help. There was this sort of charged debate. Who was right? Both of them felt like, where all of them felt like they should be following God's wishes. But what were God's wishes? first note on the sermon note sheet this morning is our past informs, not defines, our future. Our past informs, not defines, our future. It was a very good thing when the Jews, returning to Jerusalem, stopped and took stock and asked that question, where did we go wrong? How did we fail God? What does God really want from us? And how can we get back on the right track? That was a good thing to do. And even though this horrible thing, when the Babylonians come in, destroy the temple and exile the people, it's always going to be a bad memory. They can learn from it. That information of the past is extremely valuable, extremely helpful in thinking about setting a new course for the future. But the past doesn't define the future, and their goal should not be to return to the past or to stay in the past. Those things are actually impossible. Back to this debate. All this was taking place about 600 years before Jesus. When Jesus comes along, he weighs in on this debate. Is it like Isaiah said, that God wants us to care and love the hurting world around us? Or is it Ezra and Nehemiah and about being pure and righteous and holy before God so we don't stand apart from God but we live according to God's values? Which one is it? Which side will Jesus take in this debate? And so, Jesus, you may not know this, you cannot teach in a synagogue until you're 30. But as soon as Jesus is old enough, he's 30 years old, he's a brand new rabbi, he goes into the synagogue, and you know people are wondering, what is he going to teach? What is he going to say? And which side of this debate is he going to fall on? And so the first time Jesus stands up in the synagogue to teach and to read scripture, he opens up a scroll from Isaiah, the one who said that God wants us to love and care for the hurting. And this is what Jesus reads. It's from Isaiah. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free." Jesus, with this scripture, says he's concerned about the poor, the captives, the blind, the oppressed, the hurting. There can be no deliberation about where Jesus falls on this debate. Jesus believed that his Father wants for us to be concerned about the hurting and the vulnerable, to love and to care, and to not isolate ourselves from the world and be just this holy huddle that we don't allow others into. Jesus was clear. Number two on your sermon notes: our mission trumps our traditions. Our mission trumps our traditions. We all know in this congregation, and I guess in all congregations, you have elected leaders. We have our congregational council is made up of 9 people who you all elected to lead. And they do all kinds of important things. They decide how best for us to spend our money as a congregation. They keep their staff and one another and volunteers accountable to things that we said that we're going to do or things that are within our responsibility. They help us decide as a congregation where we need to focus, if there's things as a congregation we need to work on and improve. So this council is an important team of the church. But if I were to ask you, who are the council called to be loyal to? Who do they represent? What would that answer be? We know it wouldn't be loyal to the pastor. We know, hopefully, that it would not be to be loyal to us as a congregation. That's not the job of the council. The job of the council, I think we can all agree, would be loyal to God. But to say that they're loyal to God is sort of a broad way of looking. looking at things. And after all, if we think back to the history, you've got Isaiah, you've got Jesus, you've got Ezra, you've got Nehemiah, all of them wanting to be loyal to God, but all of them finding sort of different paths to doing it. So what is more true is that our elected leaders in the congregation and our staff are called to be loyal not just to God, but to God's mission in this place. We all know the mission of Mount Olive Lutheran Church: believe, belong, serve, God's work, our hands. And what that mission does is it clarifies what God thinks is important, what are God's priorities. To believe, that we believe that our mission is to help people to have this relationship with God, to trust in God for all the needs of their life. To have that kind of faith that sustains them throughout all kinds of trials of their life. We believe also that our mission calls us to belonging. Certainly belonging to God as His children, but also belonging to one another. And that one of our main purposes is to build relationships, not just with Jesus Christ as our Savior, but with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Belonging. And then serving. That we are called to love and to serve one another. And then our community around us, even extending into the world, that we're called to serve wherever we find a place that we can step in and meet a need. And so that mission says something about what we believe is God's priorities. Just like Isaiah said, God's priorities is to love and to serve the hurting. Just as Ezra and Nehemiah said, God's priority is that we are holy and set apart and distinct. It's important. It's important to understand that our loyalty goes to that mission, because that mission is God's priorities for us. Number three on the sermon notes is that Jesus calls us to get our hands dirty. Jesus calls us to get our hands dirty. In our story, you've got the Pharisees and the scribes, and they seem to constantly be watching Jesus to see what he's going to do next so they can criticize. And it doesn't seem like anything Jesus does ever meets with their approval. And today in the gospel lesson, they've seen Jesus' followers eating a meal, but before they eat the meal, they're supposed to wash their hands. Not a law, by the way, that God instituted, but a law that the elders, other scribes and Pharisees, had instituted many years ago. And so they criticized Jesus and his followers. They said, why do you all sit down to eat without following these traditions, without following these rules? And Jesus says, look, it's not about the external that defiles a person, makes a person unclean. It's about what's in your heart. Is your heart in the right place? And to be clean for Jesus meant that your heart's in the same place that God's heart is in. And like Isaiah, Jesus would say that God's heart is with those who need help, those poor, those captive, those vulnerable, those suffering, those lost. That God has an eye on all of his children, especially those who are calling out in need. And we are called in that same way. Jesus makes clear what he believes God's priorities are. He sort of settles the debates for us Christians. Is it about holiness, or is it about loving and serving? Jesus makes it clear. And our mission, believe, belong, serve, God's work, our hand, further clarifies that, helps us know what our priorities are for this place as we serve and love the community around us. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for sending your son Jesus among us to teach us, to show us your heart, and to guide us to having the same heart as you. Lord, as we in this place seek to minister in this community, help us be ever